All right, good afternoon, friends. I'm glad y'all were able to join us today. Thanks for taking time out of your day. We have Ms. Storrs over there. She's going to be scripting on our script on the TV screen. Ms. Gregory is going to be our timekeeper so that we don't spend too long talking on certain parts. And then, of course, my fourth grade math team. I'm so thankful you're here. So when we start our DDI data meeting, we always start with seeing our past success. So this is from CFA 7. The TEKS was 4.4D. The student will use strategies and algorithms, including the standard algorithm, to multiply up to a four-digit number by a one-digit number, and to multiply a two-digit number by a two-digit number. So if you look at the data, y'all did fantastic. Whatever you did to reteach, we're going to discuss that, because Gomez, from CFA number 7 to number 8, Gomez went from 50% mastery to 90% mastery. McDaniel went to 54% mastery to 96% mastery. And Singsauce went from 45% mastery to 82% mastery. So that's huge growth. What type of strategies did you use, or what do you think could attribute to that growth?
Well, I know we did a lot of repetitive practice with computation.
Right.
And so they just made sure with multiplication that we had to use it with the basic facts. Because if they didn't use their basic facts, then division was going to be harder.
Right.
Right, and then even like in transitions and stuff, we would do flashcards of division facts too, just to kind of help pick up on little facts that they need to know.
Yeah. And we had them working on a multiplication chart, so you can read it backwards for the visual, and we offered half points each time they did a chart, so that was good motivation for them.
Yeah, I love when I see the kids at dismissal working on those multiplication charts, and they love house points too, so it's kind of like double duty for everyone, so... Awesome job. We want to keep those strategies in mind for future reteach success. So the next thing we're going to do is we see the exemplar, and the focus that we're going to look at is 4.4E. The student will represent the quotient of up to four-digit whole number divided by a one-digit whole number using arrays, area models, or equations. And of course, this was our lowest TEKS from last week's CFA, so that's why we want to make it our focus for this week. So take 1 minute. In your own words, what should a student be able to know or be able to do to show mastery? We're going to look at our no-show chart and the lead forward field guide. So here's our no-show chart. And of course, when we created that in our PLC last week, we had used the lead forward field guide, our IQ release questions. But even when, now that we've taught it, there are some things that we might want to add to it. So
I think for the show, putting a top bottom chart, that's been helping out the kids a lot too.
Right.
Where they write out like 1, 2, 3, 4, all the way to 9, and then on the facts on the side.
Okay. And then, yeah. Then the showing the acronym for the family, individual family, the dad, mom, sister, brother, and Rover, those represent division, multiplication, subtraction, and remainder or repeat the steps.
I love that. So kind of an acronym to make sure that they go through the whole process.
And then on a know it to me would be multiplication, division, or inverse to each other. So they've just got to understand one to get the other part.
Right. Thank you, Ms. Storrs, for charting for us.
Yeah.
So
I'm sorry to add this.
Yeah.
The acronym, we did find out that we can do use the acronyms for like our 504 kids and our SPED kids.
Oh,
so that
yes.
We can actually add that to their,
their paper. Yeah, that's awesome. So then you're really practicing what will make them successful. All right, so that'll stay on our no-show chart for next time. The next thing we want to do is unpack the teacher's written exemplar. This was what you as a team decided for all the different strategies that a kid could use to show their mastery. And remember, these are learning documents. They're living. Even though we do the very best that we can, we know that we can add to it after we see what the students actually do. So learning from our experience, is there anything that you'd like to add? You can take a few minutes just to look at it.
Like circling and underlining the key information on the word problems would be one thing to add.
Okay.
Adding the top and bottom chart.
Oh yeah, that makes sense.
And even checking the work with multiplication for the division problems.
Good. Yeah, that kind of goes back to what Ms. McDaniel said about that they're inverse, mm-hmm. so you can check multiplying with dividing.
And the acronym.
Right.
Yeah.
Adding the acronym for students to use to check the process. Awesome. All right, so now that we've looked at the no-show chart for the TEKS, the teacher's written exemplar, look at the student exemplars that y'all brought. And we want to look right now at your student exemplars compared to the teacher exemplars. So take just a few minutes. All right, so did you notice any gaps in your student exemplars? Did students have a different way of showing mastery? Or does the student exemplar offer something the teacher exemplar does not?
On a couple of the students, they checked their work with multiplication on the division problem.
I noticed that too.
Yeah.
And I like that they were showing the different ways. It's not just, you know, the area model or whatever. They're figuring out that those things really do work and what's most comfortable for them to be able to solve the problem and check it multiple ways.
Yeah, I noticed the same thing that y'all have done such a great job at showing your students variety of strategies that they're able to choose what works best for them. So that's great.
Yeah, I had one. Yeah, I had some that used the partial quotients on theirs.
Same. Yeah. I have one that's very adamant on using partial quotients. Yeah. And I'm like, that's fine. Whatever gets you the right answer, I'm all for it.
So now that we've looked at all of the exemplar, we want to look at the gap. So look at the unmastered student work. Take 2 minutes, kind of notice what the key gaps are between the rest of the student work and then the ones who were unsuccessful. This is why it's helpful that we sort our work based on student mastery so that we can see the TEKS. I noticed that some students
multiplied on all of them.
Right.
Or they set it up looking like a multiplication, but they still put the divided, so it then confused them that they didn't know what they were actually supposed to do because they didn't put the house over the number. They just wrote divided 9, like a multiplication problem would be set up.
Yeah, they set it up vertical.
Yes.
And one of the students I have here, it would have helped if they would have put the acronym because they divided, they multiplied, but they added
right.
and not subtract.
Right.
It would have helped if they had the acronym.
And I had some that did the top and bottom chart, but then it looks like they kind of just
got wonky. That's why I'm trying to tell the kids to do a line, like
yeah.
draw lines, one line, two.
Yeah.
Oh, because it gets like
it
aligned.
Gets,
yeah.
It starts
yeah. getting, yes.
And so then they get the math facts mixed up.
Right. Yeah, and really, I kind of noticed just like the lack of division, like not using that top-bottom chart and using it to help them with their division. Like they knew to divide, but then they weren't their computation was off.
That's what I was noticing. They used the correct operation. They just struggled with how to multiply or how to divide. Yes.
All right, so we have done our whole section of see it. We are going to move on to name it. And this is where we punch it. Stamp the error in conceptual understanding. So this is where we want to look at our key area to reteach. Is it a conceptual understanding? Is it a procedural gap? What do y'all think?
I say procedural because the process is still not comfortable. They've just got to learn how to divide properly and how to solve that problem by using the steps and the acronyms. And it's just getting comfortable with the whole concept of division.
Right. I agree.
Yeah, because for the most part, they knew to divide. It's just
right.
It was just the process of still trying to figure out where to start, how to start it.
And just to teach it step by step. This is your steps to doing it, and follow these steps and you're guaranteed to get the right answer.
Right. I agree, because I noticed even in the, like, the word problems, they knew how to set up the problem correctly. So the concepts are there that they know how to, when to divide, but it's the actual just computation. So definitely a procedural gap. Okay, so we have named it. We're now going to do it. We're going to plan our, So it says write down the highest leverage action steps that students will need to close the gap. So that's what we've been saying. The steps of the division process, using the acronym.
The top and bottom chart.
Right.
And then checking your work.
Checking the work,
multiplication, the inverse operation.
Right, so the process. Okay, so now we're going to go to the do it, the plan, the reteach. So this is when we need to decide what reteach structure we want to use. Should we use modeling, where you're going to get it? This is usually when a lot of your students, around 70% or so, are just really struggling. Or do we think that maybe guided discourse, where just some students are struggling, there's some misconceptions, but through self-discovery with you prompting, they can fix?
I think modeling is going to be a key.
I think
they've just got to see it over and over and over until, because sometimes when you put that pencil in their hand, their brain, if they can just watch and understand it that way. So,
because even if you're just looking through the most of the student work, I've noticed that most of my students aren't doing all the steps that I would want them to do. So I would rather that I model it for them so they can know exactly what I'm looking for.
Well, I think it kind of depends on some of the groups and the kids, because there's some that you probably don't have to do the teaching model. Like, they kind of already have it, as someone said. They just kind of, like, in computation, they might have messed up a little bit.
Right.
So, like, those, you can probably do the guided discourse.
Yeah.
And, like, get them done, and then do the teaching and model with the ones that do need it.
Yeah, and that's something that'll be exciting to see, too, like, as you really work on that process, like, where's the breakdown in the process? Because it might just be a tiny tweak through guided discourse. So, I love that. Yeah, we can definitely differentiate our reteach. For now, I say we look at the modeling, because I think that's going to hit the, you know, take care of the most kids. So it says to select the task, identify the exemplar response. So what is the ideal answer we want to see that will show that we've closed the gap? And what is the why that we want students to be able to articulate? Okay, so if you were going to have your students practice this procedure, where would you start?
I think setting up the problem first, because, like, you know, one of the main things was a lot. Like she was saying, some of them were setting up vertical. So the main thing is set it up, because even when they had it horizontal, some of them still tried dividing when it was horizontal.
Right.
So setting it up with the, like, the way we say, with the dividend going inside the house and the divisor knocking at the door. So setting that up first.
Right.
And then the acronym.
And then after that, putting the acronym with the top-bottom chart so they're all completely set up before they actually jump into the problem.
Yeah, so it's like if we were going to look at, we want them to set it up first, then follow the process, and then check their answer.
Mm-hmm. And if I was to reteach it, I would do it in different colors each step, just so that they can see which each step would be.
I love that. I know that that was one of our lead forward strategies, where they suggested using different colors for each step so they can track it on your anchor chart.
Like for the divide step, do it in blue, multiply, red, and then so on. And then you can see each time they do it.
I love that. Yeah, and then maybe even writing the acronym, each letter in that color.
Yeah,
because then they can track it. Awesome.
We talked about checking off, too.
Yes.
After they divided, they can know, I've done the D part, multiply, check that. So for those people that need that concrete sequential just checklist, I think it will be very beneficial for your kids.
Okay, so we are going to take 4 minutes to plan the reteach. You have the link on your script. I'm going to give you 4 minutes, kind of think through your lessons through the I do, we do, you do part. And then I'll do the same, and then we can all look at each other's and compare them. All right, so now that we just took about 4 or 5 minutes to script our plan, let's go ahead and compare the different things that everybody put. Of course, we start our lesson with our anchor chart, so that includes the different things that we would want our students to do. So would y'all like to talk about what you typed?
For mine, I put that I would do the anchor chart with the like how to set up the problem, and then write the division steps in different colors with the, and then like model for them together with that, and have it in different colors so they can visualize that,
right,
with the check marks, and then also the top bottom chart on the anchor chart, so it's always there for them to reference.
And then with that, also the division family, I like drawing. So what I usually do is just to, for the kids, I actually draw like the dad, the cartoon figure of the dad, and then the mom, the sister, the brother, and the rover. And then I write next to it dad, mom, sister, and what it is. And so that, and with the same thing with hers as far as getting the steps in there too with the color coding.
Now to make sure the students understand the proper steps to solving a division problem. And it's like kind of with the same thing, but really, can you see, yes, I've done that step, it looks like that. Yes, I've done that step, it looks like that. And then check it off. And then check it once again with your multiplication. So just make sure you're correct.
All right, so if you look at the next one, it says to, on the independent practice, what will you monitor to see if they are doing this correctly? What laps will you name? So this is where our aggressive monitoring, or I know we call it AGMO a lot. What would your steps be when you're naming your laps, exactly what you want to see?
Definitely setting up the problem with writing the acronym for the first lap, the second lap being the top-bottom chart, and then solving it and checking work with multiplication.
Awesome. I think that's...
Do you have any other things you'd like to add to the laps?
I think we've just got to prove to them that setting up the problem properly is really the first step. You're not going to get solved any faster if you don't.
Right. All right, so now this is everybody's favorite part where we practice the gap. So since we chose modeling as our reteach plan, we're going to practice modeling and thinking and the precision of language. So Gomez has volunteered to be our teacher model. And remember, we're going to be students. So this is a learning experience. We want to listen to his language and, you know, help each other grow. So there's some really fresh markers over there if you want to...
All right, so we're going to practice a division process, and the number that I have is going to be 164 divided by 4. But it's set up horizontal, so can we divide this question like this?
No.
No, so what do we have to do first?
Set it in the house.
So set it up first, right? And the first step would be to put it in the what?
House.
In the house. So... Now, in order to put it in the house, how do we know what to put in the house? Let's use our math vocabulary. This number right here, does anybody know what that one is called? No one knows what this one is called? Dividend, yes. That is the dividend. And then this one right here, does anybody remember when we went over this?
The divisor.
Now, let's go ahead and put what the vocabulary is for the answer in a division problem.
The product.
The quotient. Now, the product, it is quotient, but the product, it is related to division. Can anybody help her what the product means?
I remember talking about product when we did multiplication.
Multiplication. Yes, product is the answer to a multiplication problem. In division, it's quotient, and the way they relate is what's the inverse operation of division?
Multiplication.
And we're going to use that later. Can anybody know what we're going to use it for later?
The top-bottom chart.
Top-bottom chart, and one last thing at the end, yes, when we check. Now, so now we set up the house. Who goes inside the house? The dividend or the divisor?
The big dividend.
The big dividend.
And now here, the divisor is going to be the one knocking at the door, right? Now, we're talking about a house. We're missing something. Who lives in that house?
A family.
A family, right? So a family lives in that house. So were we correct?
Yes.
Yes.
I can add to your strategy.
Okay, the one thing I noticed with my kids and with y'all, that y'all struggle with sometimes seeing a whole big number. So what I want you to do, I like the X, but if you can put your hand and cover, then you know you're just doing the four times the one, or divided by the one divided by the four. Does that work?
No.
So I know that now, because I only see that number. So then I've got to jump my hand over. Now I see 16. Can 4 go into 16?
Yes.
And then we can go back and prove using all of our information here to solve the problem. So cover your each number and make sure that you know you've started over with your hundreds, and we couldn't, so we went to the tens. And so we want to make sure that we know that we're only using one number or set of numbers at a time. Instead of looking at 164 and getting nervous, you're just going to look at one thing at a time and say yes or no, it works, and work it out that way.
I have a suggestion also.
All right, so another suggestion that I have for when you're teaching this top-bottom chart is that whatever number you're multiplying by, you can draw circles to help students count up, because sometimes if they don't know their facts right off the top of their head, this gives them something concrete to count on. So since we're multiplying by 4, you can draw 4 circles, and then they're just counting it up each time. 1, 2, 3, 4 is the 4. 5, 6, 7, 8, there's the 8. 9, 10, 11, 12, 12. And this is a really helpful way that you can also teach students to use the counters as part of, sometimes they have those as accommodations. That way they know to get out as many counters as they're multiplying by, and then that helps them fill out their top-bottom chart.
It reminds me of touch math, so that kids can actually touch the circles or the counters or just their paper to be able to...
Right, it's like touch dots.
All right, so thanks for getting up and helping each other, because I know sometimes it feels strange to be in front of your peers, but really we were able to not only show a solid plan, but then add on different ideas. Our last step is to plan the follow-up. We're going to decide when you're going to teach it, when you're going to reassess it, and when we'll revisit this data.
Okay, I think a big part would be the tutoring time in the morning as they're coming in, and when they're first fresh, and having the time to tutor them, and it'll feed into the daily groups, because we can kind of check and see if they've understood it at that point. And if not, we know, even without ACMA, we know we've already set a group that then we need to kind of see if they didn't get it then or they're still not getting it. But it just gives us an idea of what groups we have later on.
Sure, I love that.
For me, the same thing, because I start my small group right in the morning,
mm-hmm.
Just like she said, with how they're fresh and stuff, and then I do my aggressive monitoring, and I pull a second small group in the afternoon, or not the afternoon, after the lesson, for the kids that are still struggling with it.
And I'll do it during the, like, acceleration time, because then that's when you can kind of group them to see, like, where they are, if there, some are just missing the computation, some are missing the whole process, and so they're in acceleration time in small groups, you know, is what I'm gonna do.
Awesome. So then this is something that will spiral into next week's CFA.
Yep.
Okay. Yes. And then we'll revisit the data for the DDI meeting for CFA number 9.
Yep.
Okay. Awesome. Thanks so much, y'all. I appreciate your time, and I love learning with y'all.
Thank you.